Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for waiting. This afternoon will be a rare treat because the kind of cinema and the kind of filmmaker that we're here to chat with transcends so many things. Gender, race, class, focusing on the kind of cinema that we always hope to encounter and that we at RFR are extremely proud of showcasing, putting humans first, and doing so in a stylistic manner that celebrates humanity on the deepest level. He has been working very hard in the last 24 hours and before, after the Golden Globe and the 8 Oscar nominations, and believe me, it could not have happened to a nicer and warmer person. And we are extremely proud that he's here to share some of that warmth with us. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a huge round of applause to Barry Jenkins.
Thank you.
Thanks, man. Thank you. Was this on? They told me it's 3 kisses in Holland, so.
Yes. I feel very privileged and fortunate that I'm able to interview you, but I don't want to be selfish, so I'm going to share the time with you. I have some questions for you first, but then I'll give the floor to you. There's a microphone in the back, and you'll be able to ask questions. So if things pop up, just keep them in mind, and you'll have an opportunity to ask Barry later on. 8 Oscar nominations, that's incredible. And I'm going to tell you all the 8 Oscar nominations. It's Best Picture, Best Director, Best Adapted Screenplay by the original by Terrell Alvin McCraney, Best Supporting Actor for Mahershala Ali, Best Supporting Actress for Naomi Harris, Best Cinematography for James Laxton, Best Original Score for Nicholas Britell, and Best Editing for Ned Saunders and Joy McMillan.
It's a lot when you read
it's
it
incredible.
Like that.
And you know, I would love to go through every single one of them, because every single one of them, I think, has been a really important part of your process. Mm-hmm. And since it's a masterclass, I want to go through the process of filmmaking. And I couldn't imagine or dream of a better way to do it than through these Oscars, because they cover almost every part of the process. Mm-hmm. Another thing I'm really interested in, and I think you have an extraordinary voice and have made an extraordinary contribution, is the field of identity politics, especially now with Trump in office and all the debates going on. But I think for a long while, identity politics have been something that's really discussed upon in many different levels, also in the film industry. And it can be a minefield, a potential minefield. But somehow I feel that you are able to...
So you want to send me into the minefield?
No, because I think you're able, in an extraordinary way, to navigate it. Mm-hmm. With great sensitivity and also a very profound understanding. And I think even people who haven't gave it much thought or don't have that sense of understanding, they feel you do. So I think what everybody feels is they're in really good hands when you treat these issues. So I would love to talk about that, because it's a rare opportunity, I think, to talk to a filmmaker who's able to do that. Although, I have to say, I'm sorry to point my direction to the audience, there's another filmmaker in the room, and I'm... Besides from being really proud that Barry is here, I'm tremendously proud of another filmmaker that I really deeply admire. And I never thought that I would have a chance to meet him in person, but you guys are lucky because he's here. I'm sorry to highlight you, but Charles Burnett is here. Yeah. Charles Burnett has 2 films in the Black Rebels program, Killer of Sheep and Glass Shield. And I think both films are extremely important to watch. I think there are very few people who have been able to watch it, so this is a rare opportunity to do so. And Charles will be present at the screening of Glass Shields. I'm sorry, the screening of Killer of Sheep. So if you feel like talking to him, there's Q&A afterwards, so that's an opportunity to meet Charles as well. Thank you for being here, Charles. I think it's phenomenal. You graduate from film school, then you do a couple of shorts, and a lot of Barry shorts are also in the program, so that's also a great opportunity to see those. And then in 2008, you make Medicine for Melancholy. Mm-hmm. And it takes another 8 years before Moonlight, mm-hmm. but that seems like a huge leap that you've taken. So I'm really curious about what happened. And
yeah, there wasn't a lot that happened in between. You know, there were other films that I wrote that I tried to make between Medicine and Moonlight. It's interesting because it was 8 years between the release of the two films, but I'd say it was about 5.5 years between the end of Medicine and the start of writing Moonlight, which I wrote, actually I realized, not too far from here, like 100 kilometers away in Brussels was where I wrote the script for Moonlight. In August 2013, but the leap that's implied, it's interesting because it was the same editor, the same cinematographer as Medicine. I think some of the differences was the scope of the story we were trying to tell, the setting, mm-hmm. And then, you know, I was not mentored, but I worked with James Seamus for a bit after Medicine, when James mm-hmm. was still at Focus Features, and he always said, you know, the budget informs the aesthetic. And I think the same filmmakers are working in the same way on those two films, but the budget just allowed us to have a bigger scope. And so I think we're working in the same way in the two pieces, and unfortunately, the long-ass time it took between them makes that leap seem a bit larger than I think it is, because we approached it the same way.
Wow. I think most of the people in the audience had the opportunity to see Medicine from Melancholy. And I think in that film, it really showed all your qualities, all the things that we see reoccurring in the Moonlight. Mm-hmm. But you made that film like really low budget, almost no budget.
Yeah, it was $13,000 US. And we made it in 15 days with a five-person crew. And it was one of those things where, like you said, I had only made work in film school at that point. And people would ask me, you know, well, what do you do? And I'd say, well, I'm a filmmaker. And then they would always say, well, what have you done? Mm-hmm. And I'd only done these two shorts in film school that I was very proud of. And I was going through some things in my life, like most young people. And I decided to write a story, a film, that encompassed those things. And the only reason why the budget was what it was I reached out to a bunch of people in Hollywood to try to find funding for the film. But at that point, I made two very weird short films. And you know, I don't think anybody was gonna, if you've seen Medicine for Melancholy, it's not like a financeable feature. It's two people walking and talking in San Francisco in like a quasi black and white film. And so a friend of mine said he had $13,000. He wrote it on a napkin. Can you make the film for this? And I said, well, shit, I mean, I guess we can, you know? And so we went off and we made it.
And the two shorts you were talking about, that was Josephine, I think, My Josephine?
My Josephine was the first short film that I made with the same cinematographer as Medicine for Melancholy.
And
Moonlight, James Laxton. Mm-hmm. And actually Joy McMillan, who is the editor on Moonlight, and she also edited Lemon, which opened the festival last night. She was a production designer on My Josephine, I realized.
Really?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah. Wow. So we were all working
family,
together.
It's a family,
yeah? Yeah, it has to be, you know?
And also the other short you were talking about?
There's a short that I don't think you guys are playing called Little Brown Boy that I also
I'm
going to
program
State.
That next time because missed that one. Yeah, really missed that one. Because if you have a chance to see My Josephine, I love that film. And I think all your talent, all your vision is already there. The sensitivity is also there. Going from there to do a full feature length film, what was that like?
I try not to overthink any of the process involved and the things I make. So it was, again, to go back to Seamus's sort of thesis, the budget becomes the aesthetic. You know, once I had the script, and we had the budget, we kind of worked backwards from there, which was, well, how many days can we spread $13,000 over? And I guess now, not Masterclass, but I can just talk about what happened. We were like, well, who do we have to pay? You know, we have to pay the actors, we have to pay the sound guy. That became a certain amount of money. Well, how much can we pay them $100 a day for? And get them to stay on in the time we need to shoot the scenes and the script. It's like, all right, about 15 days. And so the only people who got paid on that movie were the two actors and the sound guy. All of them got paid like $100 a day. You know, so there's three people, $300 times 15 days. You know, that kind of got us into that 13 grand. I'm doing the math wrong, I think. Mm-hmm. But everything about the movie was about working backwards from, here are the assets that we have, and now let's work our way back and see how we can work. And it's interesting because at the film school I went to, we shot everything on film. And so you would get a certain amount of film emulsion. I think we got like 1,200 feet of 16 millimeter film. You'd have to do the math on how long at 24 frames per second, 1,200 feet of 16 millimeter film could last you. And working back from that, we would block out, well, how many days? You know, how many takes? How many this? How many that? And we would try to pinpoint. And if you've seen the short film, it's a very weird short film. It's in French, Arabic, and English. It's green, it's mostly out of focus. It's badass, I love it. and we had to, you know, calculate, again, working backwards from the resources we had, you know, where the risks were that we could take with the camera and things like that. So yeah, there wasn't a recalibration of, I made a short this way, but I gotta make a feature that way. I've kind of just been always making things the same way. I'm like a termite. You know, if there's wood, I'm going to gnaw at it, you know? And, you know, you figure out how much wood there is to be gnawed, and then you go and gnaw it, you know?
Wow.
I think.
You mentioned the film school. You went to Tallahassee University in Florida.
Yeah, Florida State University, the illustrious FSU Film
Yes,
School.
You made it world famous. I think they're going to have a whole tsunami of students coming in now. How I love the way Greg Tate from The Village Voice described the distance of the area where you grow up and the places where you get all the rewards. He literally said that you that where you came from was a galaxy far, far away from the places it received world cinema accolades from. Mm-hmm. So that remote place, how did you come up with the idea to go to film school? What made you decide to do that?
I kind of just stumbled into it, like a lot of things in my life. I didn't go to Florida State to go to film school. It was the only school I could afford to go to. In the state of Florida, Florida State is a very public school, and so it's state funded. And there's this Florida lottery. It's like how you buy the scratch-off ticket, you know, to try to win $1 million. What they would do is they took a percentage of that, and if you had a certain GPA, your tuition would be paid to go to any of the state schools. So Florida State is known for football, you know, not for filmmaking at that time. But I thought, oh, this is the school I can afford to go to. I'm going to go to this school. And then after 3 years of being there, I realized there was a film program. And, you know, I was kind of just stumbling around, and I wasn't fulfilled by what I was studying, which was, at first, I wanted to be a high school English teacher. And then I thought, for reasons beyond my control, I would transfer to creative writing. And then I realized there was a film school. And so I applied and I got in. And the beautiful thing about this is, you know, I grew up the way the kid in Moonlight grew up. Mm-hmm. I don't know if anybody here has seen it yet, but, you know, he's from a very poor neighborhood. And I think the only way I was on the path to becoming a filmmaker was Florida State was a public university. There was a government program that would pay for kids to tuition to go to that school. Then in the film school, we're shooting everything on film, but the school, the state of Florida, paid for all the equipment, all the emulsion, all the processing, and you were guaranteed to make a certain amount of films. So I kind of just stumbled into this vortex where everything was created, where if I did the work, I could learn the tools of making film. And so yeah, that was kind of how it happened.
And what did you discover? Because, you know, everybody knows the dynamics of an education, but I think when you're not familiar with film, you're being introduced to a world, to stories, to a whole, maybe whole universe. What was it that you learned about film, the first thing you learned about film that appealed to you?
The first thing was that I didn't know shit about it. because the first day of class, they gave you a Bolex camera, Man, open mic is killing me.
Yes, I heard too.
The first day of class, they gave you a Bolex camera and a daylight spool of film. They taught us how to load these cameras. And then they would send you off without a light meter, actually, just to film. And every week, they would give you a bit more of a tool. Second week, you would get a light meter. The third week, you would get a little bit more footage. The fourth week, you have to do a certain amount of dissolves. It was very learned by doing. And over the course of that first semester, I knew nothing about making films, like the actual craft, you know, the technical tools, the technical skill, I would say, needed. And so I took a year off. After that first semester, I had to ask myself a question. That question was, am I not good at this because I'm black and I'm poor and my mom was a drug addict, or do I just not know how to utilize these tools? Because I guess the first lesson I learned in filmmaking was, no matter how strong your voice is, you know, if you don't have a mastery of the tools, that voice is going to be suffocated. Now, you can work with people who do have a mastery of the tools, but I wanted to control the way my voice was going to be filtered through the craft. So I took a year off, and I started watching foreign films. What I realized was everybody in film school was mimicking what they were watching. So if all you watch is Steven Spielberg, and there's nothing wrong with watching nothing but Steven Spielberg, your work is going to come out in the voice of Steven Spielberg. And so I thought, well, I'm going to start watching everything else, everything that nobody else was watching, which was this Asian New Wave cinema, French New Wave cinema. And then I also started reading film criticism. I got a subscription to Sight and Sound magazine. And then I took a 35 millimeter still photography course. I wanted to make my own 35 millimeter prints.
So in a way, you organized your own education for that
I did,
year.
For 1 year.
Wonderful, yeah.
For 1 year. So I did the first semester. I didn't make my Josephine that semester. I did the first semester. It was just making short films on Bolex, 400 foot of film, actually 200 feet of daylight film. Had a very bad experience. This guy named Wes Ball, who does the Maze Runner movies, I don't know if they came out here in Holland. He was a classmate of mine. Wes was gifted from the moment. He was making Pixar shorts like on a Bolex camera, like just a brilliant cat. And then I couldn't get my images to expose properly. So, yeah, I took a year off and I wanted to teach myself, you know, how to utilize the tools. And then when I came back, that's when I made the short film, My Josephine.
Wow. The other aspect you were talking about, you said one part was a questioning whether you had the skills as a filmmaker. And
well, it wasn't about the skills. It was, you know, I knew nothing about film. Like, my concept of filmmaking was it was something cool that people did. And I knew who Spike Lee was. I knew that Spike made films. I never realized the barriers to entry. And those barriers are sometimes about connections. But in another way, the barriers are literally, you know, you can't just pick up a camera and point it, especially a film camera, like shooting a motion. You have to really know. There's a lot of pre-visualization that goes on when you're working in emotion. You know, you can't just call up the monitor and look, you know, on your, you know, 1080p monitor to see what the image is. You have to, because of the f-stop, the focal length, the frame rate, you know, you have to be able to project how this image is carrying your voice and bringing it back once you get the answer print back. So it was a rude awakening because I thought, oh, this is cool. I'm in film school. I'm going to make movies. And then it was for the first time all these other kids, you know, who were predominantly white, their images were exposing. And I had to ask myself, is it because they're white and I'm black, because they're middle class and I'm poor, or do I just not know how to utilize the tools? And so I was like, I'm going to take a year off and I'm going to teach myself how to utilize these damn tools.
How did it turn out for you?
Very well. because
right away? Because I love My Josephine.
Well, and so My Josephine is the short film I came right back and made. I don't know if anybody's seen it, but it's about a couple, an Arab-American couple, washing American flags on the night shift at a laundromat. So I wrote this right around 9/11. And growing up as a black man in the South, there was this saying then that it was like Arab-American is the new black, being Muslim is the new black. And so I thought, you know, film is this engine of empathy. You know, I'm in Tallahassee, Florida. I'm not in New York. I'm not in L.A. How can I make a commentary on 9/11? I thought, oh, I know what it feels like to be the old black. So I'm going to take that experience and try to put it into the story of an Arab-American couple. So My Josephine is about this one night on the night shift. And my roommate at the time, I was a sponge. My roommate was obsessed with Napoleon. He would walk around the apartment, random, makes no sense, just quoting all these things about Napoleon. And he had He kept talking about how Napoleon had two lovers. It was Mary Louise and Josephine. You know, Mary Louise for love and Josephine, or Mary Louise for an heir, Josephine for love. And so I thought about this guy washing these American flags as an act of patriotism and how he's obsessed with this woman, but he can't see who she truly is. So he calls her this Josephine. And it's going to be about feeling ostracized as a black man in the South, but personified through this this Arab-American couple. And it worked. It worked.
It definitely worked.
It's probably my favorite thing I've ever done, which is sad to say, because that was like 14 years ago, you know, on 1,200 feet of 16-millimeter film. But it worked. And from that moment forward, I thought, oh, okay, clearly, you know, if ever I reach a block, you know, the only thing between me and getting through that block is work, you know? I just have to do the work to utilize the tools.
You gave me goosebumps because when you tell this, this is something you feel in the film, I think, in my Josephine. There's a sense of freedom there, and that's extraordinary. And I think it almost seems that you were trying to research and explore everything you wanted to within that story. Was it necessary for you to have that process, to have to figure out what it was that you needed to be and to have as a filmmaker? I want to talk about the other aspect as well. Was it over after this research for a year and making My Josephine?
You mean was I done that I was going to be a filmmaker, or was
yes,
my development done?
Yes, were you sure about having the right tools to do it?
You know, yes and no. The beautiful thing about this process I'm going through right now with Moonlight is people go, why aren't you happier? Why aren't you blah, blah, blah? And I'm like, because when I finished that short film, I remember we got the footage back from the lab, and I was wrecked. I thought, oh, shit, this is terrible.
Really?
What have we done? Yeah. You know, I couldn't see it, or I didn't trust what I had seen. You know, when we were making the film, again, this is a different era. I can't go right to the next room and look at the DIT and see exactly what we've done. The footage came back, and the footage had a completely different voice, you know, than what I expected, you know? Mm. It was what I intended, but it wasn't what I expected. And it took a process to sort of slowly allow the film to show me exactly what was intended, you know?
Wow.
Which was this very dreamy, sort of evocative, out of focus and green kind of film. Because, you know, we're all students, so the camera jammed. I'm speaking in film terms now. The mag jammed. And so there were all these light leaks in the footage. And at first I was like, shit, we got to cut out all the light leaks. And then I thought, oh, no.
It's beautiful.
The movie is in this character's consciousness. When the light leaks, he's jumping to a different tangent. And we just, making that movie was just an amazing process.
It's beautiful. And there's, I didn't know this, but there's a sense of, you almost feel like you're going within the character. You really become the character. Mm-hmm. That's another thing that I found really extraordinary in your work, that you're able to engage me as a viewer in a way that's very rare.
Well, and Moonlight is much more deliberate. And I guess at some point we'll talk about that when we talk about the cinematography. But
yeah, we're going to go there.
Yeah, and in My Josephine, it was something that again, it happened in the process because, you know, I can't say that, you know, I came out of the box making My Josephine knowing exactly how everything was going to end up as we were making the film. I was present in the moment of making it and making some of those decisions, but the camera jammed and we got this beautiful thing that's only possible when working with emotion out of the camera jam, out of the light leak, you know, and some of the things with the focus too and the color corrections was just like, like in those days, you would like send off the footage and you would handwrite a fucking note. You like write a note. You send it off to a color timist because, you know, we didn't have a lot of money to like get back an answer print and all this other stuff and set the lights. But I wrote this long note and I remember I put photos of Wong Kar Wai. I had this music video called 6 Days back then. And I literally took photos with a still camera of my monitor of 6 Days on a laptop screen, printed them out, and then sent them to the lab with the footage, with a handwritten note. And I'm just praying it comes back the way it looked. And you've seen the film.
Wow.
I didn't expect it to come back like green and like, it's like, it's a weird ass film. but it worked. And there was nothing I could do to not make it green. At that point, it was like, this is how the colorist did it. I was like, all right, well, great. I guess we got a green movie, you know?
And it makes sense. It all makes sense. That's beautiful.
I think in the end, it does make sense. And it was a great lesson about filmmaking, which was you can't control everything. Mm-hmm. To me, I'm all about intention. You know, if you really put like a genuine intention of something, not virtuous or a proper intention, but like you work from a perspective usually the stuff comes back and it's got this energy, this essence, you know, that you couldn't control, of course, otherwise.
Well, I think everybody should see my Josephine.
I know, I wish y'all had seen it, because I'm talking all, around
this,
it now.
Yeah, it's hard to talk about film, but it's better to watch it. I want to go through the Oscars, actually, mm-hmm. with you. And while talking about the Oscars, I also want to touch sometime on the other issue you were mentioning about researching your own filmmakership. And that's the aspect of being not a usual suspect as a film student, I think, and also about being a black filmmaker in the industry. I would love to go the other way around from the Oscars and start off with the editing. Because you mentioned about My Josephine, about getting the footage back, and how the footage always has a reality of itself. Mm-hmm. So you have to redefine the film, I think, when you watch the footage. And a good editor is able to go through that process with you. In this case, the two editors, but it would be a really historical moment for a black editor to... get an Oscar.
Joy McMillan is the first black woman to ever be nominated for an editing Oscar, which is amazing.
Yeah. So it's already historic. It's already historic. I know that you are a big fan of the book Blink of an Eye. Can you tell something about that? Why is it so important to you?
Yeah, you know, shit, they turned it off. Can you guys hear me? Yeah, so you can hear me just fine. We'll see. There it is.
It works, yeah.
So, yeah, okay. The blink of an eye is... It's not working.
So we change the mic.
Mic check?
Until they change the mic, I'll just speak. So, yeah, so In the Blink of an Eye is a book by Walter Murch, who was Francis Ford Coppola's editor slash sound designer for, like, his greatest movies, Apocalypse Now, The Conversation, really, really heady stuff. Thank you.
He's
working hard. He's going to turn it on when he goes back there. And, you know, my film education, I was always looking for the most concrete sort of explanation of how to utilize the tools that I could apply in my work. And in the blink of an eye is Walter's basically very, very simple theses as someone who, again, this book is written in an era where there are no, like, computers. Everything he's doing, editing a film, there's like a piece of emotion and he's chopping it, you know, with a splicer, you know, the same way I'm sure you guys cut Killer of Sheep, right? Yeah, he's cutting it on a flatbed. So you literally, you're touching the film as you're cutting it. And Walter had, there we go. And Walter had this theory, or I guess in the process of doing all this work, Walter realized that the pathway into cinema, the gateway of empathy, is through the eyes. And he literally tried to boil it down to the essence of, as you're watching a film, when there's a cut in the scene, you know, when there's a cut literally in a shot, you're breaking this connection between the audience and the character. And so I read this book and I was like, man, this is brilliant. It's like, this is some simple shit. It's all about the eyes. Okay, great. I'm going to focus on these eyes. Because I remember growing up in, going to school in Tallahassee, there's not a million actors walking around. And so casting people for your short films was very difficult. You know, there were people who maybe wanted to be actors, but it just wasn't this pool of great talent. And I started to focus on, as I was casting for my short films, looking at people's eyes. And I felt like the longer an actor went without blinking, the more the audience was connecting with them. So as we were making Moonlight, we were casting, and I was trying to find the way to sort of have three different actors play the same character and yet carry the same essence. And I just remembered this book by Walter, In the Blink of an Eye, and I thought, I'm not worried about them physically resembling one another. There's some things with their skin tones that have to be consistent, but I'm looking for this feeling in their eyes. I'm going back to this Walter Murch theory, In the Blink of an Eye. And if you see the poster for the film, there's a sliver of each of the actor's face, and it's all connected by this look in their eyes. So it's just one of those texts. It's like the first text I ever read where, again, this barrier between me in filmmaking, this is a very privileged art form. And the States, especially when I went to film school, only kids who had grown up, not with a silver spoon in their mouths, but a certain way, those kids had the most direct path to filmmaking. And here Walter had written this very simple, concrete text, you know, about a human organ, you know, as the framework through which, you know, we can sort of enter and explore The Craft of Filmmaking. If you have not read it and you are a student filmmaker, an aspiring filmmaker, highly recommend in the blink of an eye. It's short too, you can read it in like 2 days.
And how did this work with Moonlight, with Ned and Joy? Mm-hmm. What was extraordinary for you in this process to work with them?
It was interesting. It wasn't my intention to work with two editors. You know, originally when we first began, I knew Joy and Nat were going to be working together, but what that relationship was very amorphous. We just didn't put definitions on who was cutting what and this and that. And when the footage came back, it just became very clear that because each story was so distinct, there was a consciousness in story one, there was a consciousness in story two, a consciousness in story three. And as Joy and Nat began working, it just became this thing where Joy was working on story three the most. And Joy just had this familiarity with story three. And Nat took on stories one and two. And what arose from that was the movie is about interiority. It's meant to be an immersive experience for the audience. And there was all this silence that was built into the piece, or that was built into the direction, the performances on set. And the process of cutting this film was about allowing the film to dictate to us just how silent it would be. For those of you who've seen it, our cast on set was actually quite, not quite funny, but you know, we tried to bring a little bit of levity to the set. And so there was like this really good energy, and sometimes that energy would make its way into the takes. And the process of editing this film was about figuring out the pace the scenes wanted to flow at, mm-hmm. how much silence the scenes wanted to contain. And enjoying that over the course of several months, just very slowly allowed the film to dictate to us what that pace would be.
How would you describe the quality of the cooperation with these editors?
For me or them together?
For you, yeah.
Man, I mean, we got along like peaches, you know? I mean, I've known them for 15, 16 years. And I will say they're very familiar with the way I approach cinema. Mm-hmm. So it was very fluid. You know, I remember, who in here has seen the film, has seen Moonlight? Pretty
wow.
good portion. Okay. So there's this scene in story three in the diner. And I remember when we shot that scene, there's a song by Barbara Lewis that plays. Mm-hmm. And we did something you're not supposed to do in filmmaking, which is every time we shot that scene on set, we actually play the song out loud. You're not supposed to do that because, you know, we didn't have the rights to the song as we were shooting the scene. But I wanted anytime a producer watched that footage for them to hear that song so they knew Barry Jenkins really wants this song in the film. And in the end, we ended up getting the song in the film. But there's this, where that scene ends is very complex. You know, we literally run the camera for the whole take. They're just sitting there looking at each other and trying to find the out point. It was interesting because there were several different out points. And I remember, because Joy knows intimately who I am, I just got up in the edit one day. I was like, Joy, I'm leaving. I'm going home. When I come in tomorrow, I want something better than this. Fix it. And I left. And she laughed, but she knew I was serious. And when I came back in, again, because she knows what I'm looking for, I think both of them very intimately know the feeling of the piece. I mean, if you've seen the film, that scene ends with, you know, one of the characters is just looking down. He's looking down. He's looking down. He's actually hearing on set the actual song that's playing. He's being moved. And then he looks up and Joy cut. And I was like, oh, my goodness. I gave her a hug. I was like, all right, this is why you're here. Wow. I mean, you're here because I love you and you do a great job, but this is why you're here. Yeah.
Very well-deserved nomination. Yeah. Going from here to, you mentioned it already, that you're trying to really make an immersive film. Mm-hmm. And besides from the editing quality, it also has to do with James, I think, James Lexton, mm-hmm. the cinematographer you've been working with, mm-hmm. I think forever,
yeah,
on every film. Right. I think that's also extraordinary. Can you explain your vision with James to come to this immersive cinema?
Yeah, you know, part of it was, I think if I tell you I'm making a movie about a poor black boy growing up in the hood with a mom addicted to crack, you think you know what that movie looks like and sounds like. You know, it's a very social realist, there's this style of filmmaking, and I want to describe it as a style of this very dispassionate camera, a very observant, non-obtrusive camera, and we think of that as being naturalism, but there's a sort of artifice and that rigor as well. And so I wanted to take this notion of artifice off the table. And I wanted to embrace the fact that you guys are sitting in a room watching a screen. So James and I, you know, we didn't want the movie to be beholden to the genre of the narrative. You know, a horror film looks a certain way. An action film looks a certain way. A social realist drama looks a certain way. And yet Miami is this beautiful, gorgeous place full of bright colors and bright light. And to subdue that light, we felt, would have been immoral because it wasn't truthful to the world that Terrell and I grew up in. So we started off by knowing we were going to have a colorful, bright image. And then we also wanted to work from the consciousness of our main character and not, again, from the linearity of the plot. So we decided that there were going to be moments where the camera was literally trying to convey to the audience the consciousness of our main character. And the first time this happened was, for those of you who haven't seen the film, I apologize, but this will still be visceral when you see it. But in the second chapter, there's a scene where the main character comes home, and Naomi Harris, as Paula, is waiting for him in this courtyard. And he just come home from his surrogate mother's house, and she says, "Where'd you go last night?" And for me, that scene is about, for the first time, he's realizing that his mom can become this other person. There's this dissonance and dislocation. But we filmed the scene just like these guys are filming us, you know, a very passive camera, you know, voyeuristic camera, you know, and film, the camera's always, you ever wonder this? Why is the camera always just outside somebody, you know? It's like we pretend that we're not watching that a camera's there, but we know that the camera's, why are you looking there when the camera's here, you know? Mm-hmm. You're trying to pretend the camera's not there. And so we had filmed this scene, and I realized that you guys, the audience, weren't experiencing in a visceral way what I was feeling as a human being. So I turned to Naomi and I said, "Would you mind doing that scene looking right into the camera?" And she said, "Of course, Barry. I did it all the time on 28 Days Later with Danny Boyle." I was like, "Great, Danny Boyle. Let's do it." Mm. And, and I turned to James and I told him, "Can you set the camera at 48 frames?" Because I thought if we force it to 24, I can deal with a 90-degree shutter. But also, too, I wanted to have the ability to control the image and separate it from her voice. So we rolled the camera. What's up?
Yeah, because you throw some technical terms around. Mm-hmm. What is the effect of that particular choice?
By shooting the scene at 48 frames, you know, the sound is separate from, the audio is separate from the picture. So we still recorded the audio, even though we have the picture going at 48 frames. So I knew when we got to the edit, mm-hmm. if we wanted to, we could sync up the image and run it at 24 frames anyway, but it would have this 90-degree shutter. So it would seem like the image is choppier. You know, there's less of this blur. There's this concept called persistence of vision. Is why when you go to your parents' house and they have a new flat screen TV, and you're like, "Why does this shit look so weird?" It's because the shutter, or the frame rate, is too damn high. The same thing when you're working at 24 frames in a motion film, the shutter is at 180 degrees, but if you go 90 degrees, there's less blur. So it's like when you watch a war film, like Saving Private Ryan, that's all like 90-degree, 45-degree shutter. So shooting the scene, I'm sorry, it's getting in the weeds. Shooting the scene at 48 frames, I knew that if we had to just run the whole thing at 24, we just have this 90-degree shutter. But what it gave me the ability to do was, I have this kid who's looking at his mom, right? Yeah. And he's seeing her in this different way for the first time. So I can go to 48 frames, and now we hear her voice, but her lips aren't moving. But then I can catch up at 24 frames, and now he can see her again. It's going in and out. This is dissonance for the main character. So we go and we shoot this scene, right? I've known James for like 20 years, a cinematographer. "I only want this one line, but I'm your mama, ain't I?" And we call action. She's looking right into the camera. She does the line. And then she turns to walk away. And James is beautiful. He walks with her. And then she looks back at the camera. And now I'm at the monitor watching my mom walk away from me. The camera is me. I'm following my mom to this front door. And I'm always trying to catch up to her. I'm trying to catch this voice. We get in post, and we're doing this ramp from 48 to 24. The voice is there. It's not there. And now you guys are feeling what it feels like to be me, to be Chiron in this moment. And we even take the audio. When we go to 48 frames, it goes from 5.1 to mono. And then she opens the door. It slams against the wall. And now we're back in 5.1. So I'm acknowledging that you guys are sitting in the auditorium watching a film. Let's not try to pretend that you're not, because now that you're here, just like in Hamlet, the actors are performing, you know, this goes back to like ancient times, and they go from here to now he comes and gives a soliloquy to the audience. This is not new stuff, but we pretend we're not sitting in an auditorium, we're watching these films, and I was like, you know what, we're in the auditorium, and we're going to go from here to around the room and come back, and now you guys are feeling what my main characters are feeling, so immersive cinema.
It's incredible, because it really works, yeah. Thank you so much. You know, Barry, when I saw the film, I'm coming. We're going to have screening tonight, and there's going to be a Q&A. So if you've seen the film, with everything you know now, it's going to be another experience. When I saw the film the first time, I was in tears after 10 minutes.
I'm sorry.
So I had to look through a blur of tears. And I also realized...
Immersive cinema.
Very immersive cinema. Almost intrusive immersive. but there was another thing that really touched me profoundly. And that is that besides from being an amazing filmmaker, telling this amazing story, you really were able to engage, I think, a really broad spectrum of an audience mm-hmm. to the reality of a black man growing up. And I think that is such an important thing, historically, socially, politically. So in that respect, I think you've done an amazing job in moving this forward. Is this something that was very present or conscious in your in the process of filmmaking, that you were aware of this?
You know, it wasn't. You know, I think I'm glad that that's the result of what has happened, but it wasn't a part of the process. I did a podcast with Mark Bowl, who wrote The Hurt Locker and Zero Dark Thirty, and he said the same thing. And he said, "Were you trying to make this film universal for everybody?" Mm-hmm. And I was like, I said exactly what I'm going to say now. I was like, "No, I made this film for an audience of two, myself and the playwrights, Roe McCraney. I tried to just drill down and make a movie about what it felt like to mm-hmm. be us and make sure I got it right, pursuant to the two of us." And then when you take it out into the world, I think people can choose to see themselves in the character, can use this empathy to see themselves in the character, but I do not want anybody to come in here and see their life on screen. I want them to see Sharon's life. Afterwards, Mark said, "Man, that was a softball. You're supposed to say yes, you made it for everybody." And I was like, "No, but that's just not true." You mm-hmm. know, I just tried to make as specific a film as I could about myself and Terrell McCraney. I think what happens is, I think when people see that you've created this thing that is very important, that drills down to the soil, to the root mm-hmm. of who you are and where you're from, I think what happens is, rather than trying to look all the way across the ocean to Miami and see if you can see your soil and our soil, you know, people here, if you see this film and you see something of yourself in it, you go home and you look down at your soil, you know, and you mm-hmm. try to find the similarities about your experience, but it's your relation to your place, not your relation to my place. I think that's the way art functions truly. And that was what we attempted to do in the film. I love that I've gone so many places with this film and people are finding a way to see themselves in it. But if I tried to engineer a piece that could do that, I would have watered down and diluted what it was mm-hmm. that we were after, which was to just capture what it felt like to be us growing up in Miami. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
No, thank you so much. because what another thing that I'm really curious about is that you really feel that exactly what you're saying, the profound understanding of the life you're depicting. Mm-hmm. On the other side, you're depicting a life story of a homosexual man, and you're mm-hmm. straight. I'm sorry to have you outing here.
Wait, did you just out me as straight?
I'm outing you. Yeah, yeah. It depends on what perspective you have. I don't have a heterosexual perspective.
This is true. You know, if you read anything about this film, it's going to be one of the first things you read. So.
Yeah. So how did that relate to you? Because it's not a perspective you have, naturally. I know that you find that you consider yourself a very profound ally of the LGBTQ community. At the same time, you wanted to be sensitive. So how did that work for you?
Yeah, I think it's one thing to be a passive ally and another thing to be an active ally. You mm-hmm. know, when the Supreme Court passed the bill in the U.S. Making same-sex marriage a constitutional right, you know, Facebook allowed you to put a rainbow flag over your profile, you know, which is cute, but that's being a passive ally, you know, and I wanted to be an active ally. I also think, though, there are certain narratives that demand a first-person perspective. Not that if you don't identify with a character or community, you can't make a story about them, but I do think to maximize the possibility in any story or experience, you need some first-person perspective. And so with this piece, there was hesitation on my part about whether or not I could do justice to this character, whether or not I was the right person to tell this story. But then, as you said, you know, I consider myself an active ally, and I had Terrell McCraney's words, and I had Terrell McCraney himself to work with, to speak to, and I thought if I can harness his voice, if I can respectfully mm-hmm. Retain his voice, and do justice to it, that I could take ownership of the piece. And that was the sort of journey I had to make, even before writing the script. And there came this moment where Terrell called me up, and he said, because I was trying to get him to do the adaptation himself, because again, I was very aware of the issue that we're talking about, and he became a MacArthur genius. He was too damn busy being a genius and shit. And so, you know, because he has a whole other career in the theater world, and he was, you know, getting his work out into the world. And he said to me, you know, just go with God. And he said, you know, I trust you. And once he said that, Chiron became me. And, you know, I grew up the same way this kid did. We grew up in the same neighborhood. Our moms were through the same thing. Everything about my life is Chiron's life, with the exception of his sexual identity. And so if this difference of sexual identity was so massive that it kept me from identifying with this character whom I share everything else with, then that was me saying, hey, homosexuality is this thing that just makes this character inhuman in a certain way. Because if there was any other difference, you know, if he had one leg or if he had this or that, I'd be like, oh, okay, yeah, I can sort of feel what that's like, and now I can make this piece. And so it was like, there's no way I'm not going to make this film. This is the perfect empathy engine for me to place myself into. And Terrell had my back, and I had his words, and they were very damn good words. So.
Wow. And Terrell really testifies on the process with you and the sensitivity in which you took this whole process. There's a filmed conversation with Cameron Bailey of the Toronto International Film Festival, where the whole crew is present, and Terrell tells about the process of writing with Barry on this play, on this film, actually. Oh, I'm almost at the point of getting really selfish and keep on talking with you, but I think I have to give the floor to you guys, unless you don't have any questions, and I'll keep on talking with Barry. Okay, then I have to ask you, can you see the microphone there on your right side? So walk up there, and I think there's going to be a small line, but that's okay, because we have 40 minutes left, Marika?
Yes? Really?
Okay. All right. Hi, thank you for being there.
Great film. I loved it. And the funny thing is that it was also very much about, I mean, I could relate to it so much. It's also about a young white gay boy growing up in Holland. It's basically the same story. What I wanted to know is, you worked both with non-actors and actors in this film. How did you get them? Because they are so similar. They have such a similar style of playing. How did you get that?
Yeah, my one of my favorite filmmakers, especially when I was in film school, is Lynn Ramsey. And in Lynn's first few films, she was famous, notorious for blending non-actors with actors in Ratcatcher and Morvan Caller. And she always spoke about this tension that arises where the trained actor cannot rely on old tricks, cannot rely on muscle memory to react to the person they're in scene with. So it was something that I spoke to James about, because we knew our shooting style would have to be altered a little bit. You know, when you're working with non-actors, you can't be as rigorous with some of the technical aspects of the process. But then also, too, the movie is about Miami, and we made some very sharp choices in the production approach to the film by setting it in Miami. For example, our budget could have gone a lot farther had we gone to a different state in the U.S. where they have these tax incentives. We lost money by making the film in Miami. But what we got out of that was, I wanted the voice of the city to be a part of the piece. And so it was one of those things where we did a lot of work searching for non-actors who we felt like we could trust in scene to give us what we needed as characters, not just as the people they were. But I didn't direct them any differently than I did the others. There was something about speaking to Alex Hibbert that was different than speaking to Mahershala Ali, but I tried to use the same voice. Over the course of the project, who was a non-actor and who was an actor, that line became blurred to the point of non-distinction. And so it was just one of those things where, thank you. Look at the gentleman.
Thank you.
He brought a glass for each of us. Yeah. Such a gentleman. So there wasn't a difference in directing them. I will say My direction to a guy like Alex Hibbert, who's never acted before, who plays Little in the first story, was maybe, to be honest, more direct than it was to the actors. Rather than talking about emotions or meaning, I talked to Alex about what we needed to do. And then it got to the point where I would start telling him something. He'd be like, no, I got it, Barry. Just a brilliant kid. Thank you, Brent.
Can I just add a bit, because you were talking about how to depict or represent Miami, yeah. And you already practiced that, I think, pretty thoroughly in your film Chlorophyll.
Yeah.
And I really love the way you did that. Is that also the reason? Was it on purpose? Were you already thinking about Moonlight?
You know, I kind of was. I wasn't thinking about Moonlight because Chlorophyll predate. Chlorophyll's a short film. The only other thing I've ever made in Miami that I made with the same group, this group called Borsch, that passed me the play that ultimately became Moonlight. But I've never worked without a script before, and I've never worked with non-actors. And so Chlorophyll is this short film set in Miami. I was at a party and there was this young woman there. And I thought she was fascinating. And I said, hey, you want to be in a movie? And she was like, sure, I've never acted before. I was like, perfect. I've never directed a film without a script before. And so we went off and we made it. And I think ultimately it ended up becoming something of a blueprint for how we approached Moonlight, for sure. Yeah.
So that's another I think when you watch that film and you're informed now with Moonlight, you can see already something's happening. Cheers, Barry.
Cheers. Yeah. Wait, how do you say it in Holland?
I'm sorry,
no, it's
guys.
Like
it's.
How do you say it in Holland? In Dutch?
A proost.
Proost.
Proost. Okay, we'll have a proost with everyone afterwards. hello. You have
Hi.
A question?
Hi, Barry. Thanks so much for being here. I know we talked a little bit about cinematography already, but I was wondering if you could talk a bit more about the colors in the movie and sort of like the story you were trying to tell through the colors. I was so blown away by like every single scene and like how I felt like there was a specific thing happening with the colors.
And you're already doing it in the medicine for melancholy also.
Yeah, a little bit. We try not to be too overt with the color blocking in the films. Celine Sciamma did a beautiful job with it in the film Girlhood with the color blue. And I saw that film, and unfortunately, I was like, well, shit, we can't do that. Because our Moonlight, our movie's called And Moonlight Black Boys Look Blue. So we tried to be a bit more subtle with it. I think in the third chapter, the color blue takes on a bit more resonance than it does in the early parts. But again, the movie's meant to be an immersive experience for the audience. So the times we're most aggressive with the color blocking are times when it's in the consciousness of Chiron. So in the second story, when he has the dream about Kevin, and in the third story, when he has the dream about Kevin, that's when we're doing very aggressive things with the color. For me, visually thematic thing we did with color was all about the Paula character. In the first story, there's this light at the end of this hallway. And again, working intuitively, I remember getting to set, because Naomi's work we had to do in 3 days. And if anybody sees the film tonight, I'm going to retell some of these stories. I apologize. We had to do all her work in 3 days. And so we only had her in each location one time. And when you work that way, you have to utilize the location as much as possible. And I remember getting to this apartment and looking down the hallway and realizing that this hallway symbolized this distance that cannot be traversed by these two characters. And I knew we wouldn't production-wise go in the bedroom because we couldn't afford to production design it, but I wanted the bedroom to have a presence as this place that Chiron cannot go, this place of darkness for his mom. And we tried to, I don't know if there's like, there's a Freudian or Keynesian thing, something with like color temperature and how it relates to psychology. And we kind of looked it up a little bit. And then we went in the room and we just started dialing up this color, like literally manually dialing it up, the color temperature. And we ended up with that sort of like pink, and that's right, we're in Holland. We ended up with that pink red light symbolizing this thing for Chiron's mom and what goes on back there. And so it wasn't about trying to chart a path across the film, but there were certain places where the spirit of Chiron moved us. And so we did a little thing, yeah. Thank you.
Great question. Thank you.
The color timist on this film is this guy, Alex Bickel, who also did the film Mother of George. He is a brilliant color timist. And so if you guys have a film, you should look him up, Color Collective. Mm-hmm. He likes working with new filmmakers. There's a lot of young faces out here, so I imagine some of y'all on the brink of making y'all's first features. Yes.
Hi, thank you for your words. I was wondering, because when you guys were talking about intended audiences, that you just had the intention of making it for yourself and the playwright. And I read an interview with him, I think in The Guardian or something, and he talks about your collaboration and also how, I think the interviewer asked him, like, how was it to watch the movie for you? And he said it was very beautifully shot and beautifully made, but I also had some bittersweet feelings about it because I was looking back at it, and I'm obviously, like, paraphrasing, but he was like, there are themes of, like, identity that I still struggle with now in my life, so it was, like, kind of bittersweet in that sense. Can you maybe tell us a little bit about your collaboration with him and, like, how you look back at your own film, Moonlight, like that?
Yeah, I think for Terrell, his relationship to the film is very different than mine. You know, the movie is more his story. It's more autobiographical for him than it is for me. So I don't have the same, I have a bit of a remove that I needed to have as an artist to make this film. I think if Terrell had to be the writer and the director on this piece, it may have destroyed him. Because as he says, there's some things in this movie that he still has not reconciled. I tried to be mindful of those things, and yet I had to go off and create this character. And then this character had to be embodied by all these actors and all these technicians. So there's this distance that gets created. And I understand exactly what Terrell is talking about. I remember the first time I showed it to him, it was kind of the version you guys saw, but it was like more of a rough cut. And we like rented a theater just like this. And I remember he got up and he was walking out, and then he just sat at the door and he just sat there, just staring into space for like 20 minutes. Wow. And I didn't want to touch him because, you know, it's like, this is this guy's story. And then finally, he was like, I don't know how many times I can watch that. And he said exactly what you just paraphrased from The Guardian, because there are things in it that I have not reconciled. So the source material, if you've seen the film, in the third chapter, there's this phone call that happens between the main character and this other guy, Kevin. And the source material, the movie stops there. You know, Black does not drive back for this reconnection, because I think Terrell had not reconciled what that relationship was. So I do think it's bittersweet for him, because the actors do such a great job that, I mean, it's basically him and his past, you know, being walked around by all these very talented people. And I don't know what it would feel like to watch that if I was him. And I just feel blessed that he allowed me to put it up on the screen. For me, the stuff with Naomi Harris, with the mom, I feel the same way as Terrell. You know, I'm very proud of the work we did, but it's very difficult for me to watch, especially with a group of strangers. So I take it off the table, and I don't watch it with a group of strangers, you know? And I don't talk to The Guardian about how it makes me feel to watch it. Thank you.
Hello, I want to ask, I want to say this is, I didn't know you were straight, but you can tell it by the movie, so I thought that was really well done. And I say this is on par with films like Brokeback Mountain, who tackled the gay thing very good. And I thought that, I'm sorry, I wrote it down so I didn't forget it. But yeah, I'm a bit nervous. But why did you choose to film in anamorphic, and did you storyboard the scenes? And I saw you use the 35 millimeter and a 55 millimeter, and what was the budget, and do you know any Dutch films that you like?
Okay.
That was
great.
Amazing.
So, yeah.
I've done a lot of Q&As. Usually you don't get that kind of first comment with a very technical question. That was amazing, bro. Much respect. Thank you for that first compliment. I'll take that. Again, but I was trying to preserve Terrell's voice, so I'm glad that you didn't realize I was straight. Compliment. we chose the film on anamorphic because I have this character who is sort of floating in his own life. You know, I didn't want to film it as a Western. I did want to orient Chiron in the center of frame as often as possible, and so he could have the choice to go left or go right, and yet he continues on this path. We have this character who, until you know the last third of the film, is really sort of like an observer in his own experience. And so the anamorphic format, I mean, we could have done 2-3-5 not anamorphic, but you know, what the hell's the interest in that? And then also too, the certain focus aberrations you get with the anamorphic lenses. And again, we have this character in the center of frame, an anamorphic that's always gonna be sharp, as you get further onto the edges, you know, it's going to get less sharp. So Claire Denis is my favorite filmmaker. I remember watching her films and being like, what the fuck lens is she using all the time? You guys are recording. I'm sorry, I'm cursing so much.
It's okay in the Netherlands.
There you go. Yeah. And she's always using her favorite lens, the 50 millimeter. And so in film school, I started using the 50 millimeter. And anamorphic at 35 is closer to 50. And we had these Hawk lenses. They don't run like 25, 35, et cetera, 40. They go 25, 35, 45, 55, 65. It's really weird. So we used the 35 and the 55 pretty much on this film. What else you got?
What was the budget, and do you know any Dutch film? And also, how many shots did you do? Because I've never made a film, but I would love to make one day. And I don't know how all of this works. So.
Yeah. well, for somebody who doesn't know how this works, you got very
with
good questions.
All this information, you can probably.
what was the question?
The first question was
your budget.
The budget, I'm not going to say. Professionally, we say under $5 million is what the budget was. How low under $5 million? Anybody's guess. But
okay.
But maybe low. And then,
If you know any Dutch films?
Yeah.
Off the top of my head, I can't say. I would have to dig in my phone and look at my list.
Okay.
And then...
How many shots? Yeah.
Shots? Ooh, it depends on the scene. You know, and the swimming scene where Mahershala Ali is teaching Alex Hibber how to swim, that scene is 9 takes, you know? And, like, literally, not 9 takes at 9 different angles, like 9 shots. Because this storm was coming in, we only had 90 minutes to film it. You know, I said earlier... The budget informs the aesthetic, you know? Mm-hmm. Depending on the amount of time you have, that's the amount of time you have to make the scene. And then the lenses, 35, 55. I'm sorry, bro.
Yeah, did you work from morning till, from 9 to 6 or something like that? Or
yeah, I'm gonna make this the last one so I can get on somebody else's question.
Yeah, because there are more questions coming.
It depended on the day, but I don't like to work 18 hours. So this wasn't the kind of independent film where for 25 days you work 18-hour days. We worked pretty much 10 to 12 hours a day because, you know, the mind needs to be rested. And I like to run my sets kind of like a family. So it was a very enjoyable process making the film.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, bruh. For somebody who's not made a film, you know a lot about the process,
yes,
man.
Yes.
Okay. I'm a little short, but...
Hello.
Hello. Thank you for being here, Barry. At the beginning of the talk, you mentioned the crew of filmmakers you assembled around you, and you said that they should be like family. I'm currently trying to assemble my own family within my artistic practice. How do you assemble such a great group of creatives around you, and what do you bring to the table to keep on growing the relationship?
How do you raise a family? Yes.
I know. I think for me, the biggest thing I got out of film school wasn't this idea that, you know, you go to a film school and they teach you everything. You know, it was about the relationships I built with the people I was in school with. And I honestly probably learned more from the kids I was in film school with than I did from the professors. But that was their point. That was why it was such a do film school. You get a camera, you go off. The professor doesn't go off with you. You go off with your classmates. So are you in film school?
Not film school, but art school. But okay. I focus on moving image films. So.
Gotcha. So I think the people that you're in art school with, I think you just have to, you know, figure out who you vibe with the most, you know? Everybody on this film, we have a really good time with. Like, we drink together. Like, we go out and watch games together. Like, we have a real good time together. And then I think we've all developed our craft, not at the same rate, but alongside one another. And so I think James Laxon is a guy who shot, like, 12 features between Medicine and Moonlight. So he's been developing his craft, you know, as I've been trying to develop my voice, you know, same thing with Joy and Nat. I think you want to try to find people now. I'm not going to ask you how old you are.
Okay.
Are you under 20? You're under 25, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, you got plenty of time. I would say don't rush it and just take this time in art school to figure out who you vibe with the most, like whose work inspires you for sure and who understands your work the most. That's the most important thing. If you make something and somebody else in your class gets it, you want to try to hold on to that person, all right? Because you need somebody you can bounce things off of. And don't rush it, man. Don't rush it.
Okay.
Cool?
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah. I'll say I made my first feature 5 years after I graduated film school with a crew composed entirely of people I went to film school with. So you got plenty of time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Hi. I've got a question about something else rather than image. I'm a musician myself, and I go to art school. And I love how in Moonlight, the music and the images really worked really well together. And can you tell me a little bit about the reason behind the choice of music you made? Because I listened to the playlist on Spotify from Moonlight without the images, and it still tells a story itself. So
yeah, that's the last comment is key. You know, I knew the kind of music I wanted in the film, and some of the music is written to the screenplay. Like the Barbara Lewis song that plays in the diner is written into the screenplay. The lyrics are literally written into the screenplay. But then the score is this whole other thing. I knew the tone of score I wanted. I knew the instrumentation I wanted, that it was going to be sort of a chamber orchestra. But we didn't try to start composing music before we had the film. The composer, Nicholas Patel, Academy Award nominee, Nicholas Patel, he was very cool about, he lives in New York, I live in L.A., and after we had a pretty good cut of the film, when the film was like 90% what it was going to be, I started going out there. And your last comment is key, because rather than him writing music and us trying it in the film, we would sit together and we would watch the movie. And then we would play certain demos, instrumentation for the film. And what happened was we did it in sequence. And so as the character evolves, the score evolved as well. To the point that if you've read anything about the music in this film, or if you've seen the movie, near the end of the film, the character's becoming more masculine, and we have this hip-hop in the States. It's a good test audience. If I say Chopped and Screwed, does anybody know what that is? Can you raise a hand? So Chopped and Screwed is a style of hip-hop in the States, primarily in Texas, but also in Florida, where they slow hip-hop down and they alter the pitch. It gets very bassy and, quote-unquote, very masculine. But in this masculinity, the lyrics are slower, so now you can actually hear what people are saying. And there's a lot of pain and yearning in hip-hop, but the BPMs are so fast that we often don't catch it. So in Chopped and Screwed, all these screw artists think they're making the music sound a lot tougher, but what they're actually making it sound is way more sensitive and vulnerable. And so in the film, the hip-hop, the source cues are getting more masculine as the film goes on. And Nick, because we're watching the film, we're telling the story with the music, he started chopping and screwing the violins as well. And so it's this beautiful thing where I do agree, if you take the film and take the images away and just listen to the score, Nick is also telling a story, to the point that our end credits suite, that cue, there's this song that plays on the beach during the most sexually overt scene in the film. It plays again in the kitchen, mm-hmm. and then there's a song that plays when Kevin is making the chef special. The end credits suite is a journey back through the film, chopping and screwing those three cues, and then coming out of chopping and screwing to the character's birth with his violin and cello and piano. So great observation. And I think the reason why it feels that way is because rather than imposing music on the film, Nick and I would watch the movie and let the characters tell us what was appropriate in the score. Working with him was amazing. Really sharp cat.
Okay, dope, thanks.
And so who's the young woman in art school? Are y'all friends? Oh, okay, well, y'all better be friends, all right? Hey, you hear me? Hey, look at me. Y'all need to be friends, all right?
There you go. Small family, yeah. Okay, I'm really sorry, but I think we have 5 minutes left, so okay. Could you share those 5 minutes between the four of you?
I promise, I'll make my answer shorter. I'll make my answer shorter. We'll get through them all.
Yeah.
Hi, Barry. I've been looking forward to seeing this film for such a long time now, so I'm excited to see it tonight for the first time. I'm an art student as well. I study animation, and next year I'm going to have to work on my graduation film. But I'm always like really interested in like filmmakers who really appreciate intimacy, and I feel like that's really important in your work. How do you keep treasuring intimacy and sensitivity and authenticity in your work?
It's just sort of, I guess, my approach to storytelling, and it's also a key component of the work of the filmmakers I admire. You know, I don't think your influences necessarily become your aesthetic, but they definitely get into the way you approach the work. So, you know, Claire Denis and Wong Kar-wai are probably my two favorite filmmakers, and I think intimacy is a big part and nuance of what they do. What I try to do is have that same feeling on set. So I guess the most concrete answer I can bring is that what you're speaking of sounds like an emotional or intellectual sort of endeavor, but you want to make that concrete and the process of what you're doing. And, you know, any of the actors in this film will tell you, when I'm on set, not that it's quiet all the time, but I try to make the intimacy that we're trying to get into the scenes a part of the way we're building the set as well.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Brad. That was only 1 minute, see?
I'll be really quick. I didn't see Moonlight. I did saw the other film you made 8 years ago. How did you get noticed with that picture? How did you, after you made this film for a limited budget, how would you go about approaching festivals, getting out there, getting noticed, and go on from there?
Yeah, it was a combination. We started that film at the South by Southwest Film Festival. And I have to say, I have been very fortunate to have had some very key champions, some key film critics and film programmers champion the work. Now, there's a bit of work involved in that. When I was at South By, nobody knew who the hell I was or what this film was. And if you have a film at a festival, there's all these booklets they give you. If you guys are at Rotterdam, they give you a booklet. Usually in the back of that booklet, everybody attending the festival is listed in that booklet with key contact info. They do this for a reason. I was at South By, nobody knew who the hell I was, and we had three screenings. The first two, nobody was there. So then my producer was like, well, shit, let's get some whiskey, let's sit down. We're gonna email everybody in the back of this book who we think should see our film. And so we sent emails to everyone, and this woman from the Toronto Film Festival, Jane Schodel, replied to our email, and she said, hey, you know, I got your email, you guys sound really sweet. I just got back to my hotel, I don't know if I can see another movie. And my producer said, you know what, we will come and get you. Wow. And she said, all right, I'll get in the cab, I'll come and see your film. Again, this movie, nobody knows who I am or what this film is, and she programmed us at Toronto. Now at Toronto, we get way more press coverage, and A.O. Scott from the New York Times writes a review and makes us a critic's pick. The story has more legs. So now out of this, I get signed at CAA, and there's a company called Plan B, run by Brad Pitt. They watch every damn thing. They see a review about my film in the New York Times, they go and watch it, and they're like, hey, you seem like an interesting guy, what are you working on? 6 years later, I introduce their movie 12 Years a Slave, and they go, what are you working on now? I go, hey, I just wrote this film, adapting a play by Terrell McCraney. And 3 years later, they are the producers of Moonlight. So it's a little bit of luck and chance, but if we had not sat down in that hotel room and wrote every single body in that book and email, those women from Toronto would have never known who we were. Right. And so you gotta be active, bruh. Got to be active.
It's chaos. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, I first want to congratulate you on your nominations. I was following them yesterday in my lecture. I had my earphones just following the live stream. He actually answered my question during his question, because I wanted to know how the project came to fruition, Moonlight, but then you just said the Plan B with everything with Brad Pitt and his company. So yeah, that was actually pretty funny, because you said you wrote the script in Brussels, which is funny because I'm from Belgium, so that's pretty funny to know. I didn't know that. actually you just answered the kind of question. So maybe it's like explaining, because like, you wrote the script, and then how did it go from there on? I mean,
Well, actually, we're running out of time.
Okay,
yeah.
There's no problem.
is it okay for you to run a little bit late?
He was waiting. Yeah, get home, boy.
Thank you. I already answered that one, kind of.
I mean, I wrote the script, and Plan B got onto it. They got A24 onto it. It was a very privileged experience part, making this film.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brett.
Hi, shout out to you, man, for giving me this chance to ask my question. Good to have you here. I'm an actor here in Holland, and as a black actor, it's very difficult to find storage which kind of resonate with the depth of your own experience. So I'm very excited to go and watch your movie tomorrow. And I'm curious about, like, how much freedom did you have in the creating process without the influence of, let's say, producers or people who could say, I'm not happy with the characters or I'm not happy with the story.
Yeah. So this will tie into Homeboy's question he didn't ask. So here we go. So I wrote the script in Brussels, and then I flew back to Telluride, introduced 12 Years, reconnected with Plan B, and then after about 6 or 7 months, Plan B brought A24 on, and then we were off to the races. The beautiful thing about that process is, you know, Plan B, you know, is a heavy studio. You know, it's Brad Pitt. You know, it opened a lot of doors. You know, A24 normally only distributes films, but they decided to finance this one. So they already knew. We didn't have to take the film to market. There was no place we had to go and sell the film. So there's two things off the table. This was 20 years ago. the access that you get with a company like Plan B, usually you got to trade something for power. You know, usually somebody opens a door, and as you said, they go, now that we open this door for you, let's tell you how your voice needs to be filtered. But I always try to shout out Plan B and A24 and Mr. Brad Pitt with all his beautiful blonde hair, because what the process of making this film was, we're going to open this door, and then you and Terrell just walk through it. Yeah. I'm not going to tell you how to fix your voice. I'm not going to tell you, you know, how to, I'm not going to touch your hair, to quote Solange. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it was like this, and the whole process of it, this movie arrived pretty much unfiltered, I have to say. To the point that we opened the film with this track by Boris Gardner. You know, that's a decision that only happens when people are not telling you what to do with your image. Now, not everybody can have that experience, but it was the experience we had on this film. And so I never had to bother with someone giving me notes that weren't that would take the piece out of my voice. We still got notes on character and things like that, but I had the right to reject those things. And I think it's why we have a film where certain characters just disappear from the narrative. And we have a film where you have three actors whose faces you've never seen before, and a color palette that people don't normally see in a social realist drama, because Mr. Pitt and Plan B and A24 were like, you know what, you do you, bruh. And we did us, and here we have 8 Oscar nominations.
Wow.
Imagine that. Yeah. Imagine that.
I want to say something. Meanwhile, I'm going to ask you if there's anything that nobody asked for but you would like to share as a closing word. The answer you gave to the last question, I think, that also makes clear how important it is that there are gatekeepers within the industry who clear to make a pathway, yeah, and to give way to voices. So every single gatekeeper in this room, please open the door, mm-hmm, and let the voices come out. Is there anything you want
to
say?
I don't have anything to say, but I'm still thinking about Homeboy's question. So if there is Dutch cinema that you guys think I should be watching, hit me up on Twitter or Instagram or Facebook. I would love to have my horizons expanded. So I'm at Bandry Barry on Twitter and Instagram. B-A-N-D-R-Y Barry on Twitter. Please, give me some recommendations, bro. All right?
Wow.
Cool. That's all
you
I
all got.
Got
that? All right, Barry, thank you so much. Thank you for being here. Thank
Appreciate
you for doing
y'all.
What you do. And we'll see you tonight, huh?
Yeah. I'm sorry about the mic, but it makes me way more comfortable.
No, but you did a wonderful job. Thank you all for being with us. And I hope to see you back tonight at the screening of Moonlight.
Proust.
Proust. Thank you so much, Barry. Thank you.